Hi guys! A lot of times when we get our first offer letter, yes, we are very excited, but it can also be extremely overwhelming because we see a lot of words that we don't know the meaning of and a lot of numbers, and we are unable to understand in the end how much money will we end up getting in our bank account. Because sometimes the CTC can be a lot, but the money that we end up getting in our bank account might be very less. Why does this happen? And suppose two companies are giving us equal CTCs, does that mean that we end up getting equal amount of money in hand in both the companies? We all should have this basic knowledge to understand the different components of our salaries, and that is what this video is about. And trust me, it's not easy to understand these things. Sometimes it takes a lot of times. Even people with experience don't really understand what their offer letter means in detail. So I hope this video is helpful. I'll be discussing all the components of salaries with him. I'll also ask him my doubts. Like a person who is starting from just beginning, this is a beginner level video. We are going to discuss everything in detail. But before getting started, let me tell you about the sponsor of the video. Cryo is a project-based learning platform for you to learn new development skills and land top dev jobs. At Cryo, you will learn full stack or backend development by building internship-like projects in a real developer environment. At the end of the program, you will get to walk away with multiple projects in your resume, new dev skills, and a fantastic GitHub profile that should impress literally any recruiter. You also get personalized career assistance to land your dream job in software development. Use the link in the description below to get 10% additional scholarship to their signature programs and unlock free resources. It's a great opportunity to get placement to build up your good GitHub profile. So do check it out. The link is in the comments. So Papa, let's start discussing the components of salary. What all things are there?
Kirti, let me first thank you for inviting me again on your channel. So you wanted to know about the components of the salary. So let us take example of any private sector. There is a different structure in public sector, in state government, in central government. So let us forget about it today and let us concentrate on the private sector. So basically, there are four important elements in any salary. There can be many, but let us concentrate on the four. The first is basic pay. Second is HRA. Third is your contribution towards retirement benefits. It could be towards provident fund, pension, gratuity, and the fourth part is the flexible allowances, which can include any of the main allowances like your medical allowance, your education allowance, conveyance allowance, meal allowance, and many allowances can be designed to take care of those things.
So meal allowances and all that. So if I'm getting free meals at office, like free lunch, free dinner, so that is actually part of my CTC.
100%. The CTC itself is implies cost to company. So any cost which is incurred by the company on the employee is added towards CTC.
So it's not actually free.
It is not free. Nothing comes for free.
Okay, coming to CTC, can we talk about what exactly is CTC? What all things are included in CTC?
As I told you, all these four components.
But there are other things as well, right? Stocks and all.
Stocks, separate. See, suppose if it is part of your salary structure and the company has decided to, it is not a welfare measure or as a gift.
But if welfare it is, measure?
Welfare means suppose there is some celebration in the company. Okay. Say some silver jubilee is there or 10 years completion is there and company decides to reward every employee with some stock options. That is something different. But when it is comes to a structure that every year you will be getting say 25 stocks or 10 stocks, then it is part of the CTC.
Okay, got it. Okay, so coming to a lot of questions around CTC.
Yeah, sure, please.
The first one is, what I have seen is that what people do is, nowadays companies give stocks like, you know, for a duration of time, like for a period of 3 years, 4 years. So what I see, the company doesn't really mention in the offer letter that this is exactly your CTC. They mention like, okay, this is your, these four components, and then stocks are written at the bottom. So when someone asks, like a person XYZ, that what is a CTC, the person just adds the entire stock amount enters the CTC, even though it is for a duration of 4 years. That's wrong, right?
Kirti, first of all, yes, it is wrong, as you said. Say, suppose 100 shares are spread over 4 years. So for 1 year, it is only 25 shares.
Right.
Now, the companies are so transparent today that if you ask your HR guy or your accounts guy, he'll give you a breakup of the CTC. So he cannot include 100.
He or she, definitely.
He'll be able to give you, or she will be able to give you, the entire breakup of the CTC.
Right.
And you are entitled to that breakup.
Right. So actually, a lot of times this happens, that wrong calculation of CTC happens because of this period of time thing, right? What I've also seen is that sometimes these stocks get redeemed after like a duration of 3 years. And I might end up leaving after 2 years.
That is unavailed package.
Right.
Because what, suppose you are to, the structure says that these stocks can be redeemed only after 3 years. There's a lock-in period of 3 years. So if you are not serving the company for 3 years, then normally what the companies do normally is that in the first year they may not include it in the CTC. Second year also they will not include it in the CTC. They may include it only when they are in guest. So, but for you also, it is better not to include it in the CTC. If you are not sure. Okay, but when you are negotiating with a company for your structure, definitely you can say it is a deemed CTC. That if I stay with the company, I'll be earning 25 stocks also.
Okay. First of all, let's talk about what is negotiating a structure. Like, that is how much component I want as these four components, basic HRA and all, and how much component I want as stocks, right?
Normally, a good company has a fixed structure.
Okay.
They will say that the basic pay has to be so much. Your flexible allowances, you can choose about so much. Then HRA, this much is there are government rules also. In metros, how much you can give, and then other cities, how much you can give. So within a good company, which is following the corporate governance norms, will definitely have a structure. And that structure is always suited towards employee. Any company will try to give maximum benefits to the employee so that they stay with them, they are able to retain the talent. And once you are negotiating on the total package, CTC, then you should be careful and talk to them that while calculating the CTC of the previous company. Say, suppose you are getting meal allowance. It may cost you 200 rupees per day. Conveyance allowance, you have a pick up and drop facility, free cab facility. So all this is costing to you. If the company is not providing those benefits, then the equivalent amount of the cash should be added to the CTC.
Right. Which gets me to my next question.
Yeah, tell me.
What exactly is in hand? Like, what we get per month, right? How is it calculated? Like, which all of these components are included in our in hand salary?
Very good question. Kirti, then I would suggest that we should at some time, whenever it is convenient to you, and if your audience want, we should also talk about the tax planning.
Yes.
Then only we'll be able to talk what is the take-home salary. Because what happens is that most of these allowances, what we are getting, as the first is the basic and the allowances, most of these allowances are either exempted from income tax, subject to certain terms and conditions.
And that is what confuses us the most, subject to terms and conditions.
Kirti, you should not say that. Because why? Because we are in a digital age. And everything comes for free. Every information is for free. Just to take your example, you have learned coding for free. You had not joined any classes, and you are basically an electrical engineer. And you are teaching for free now. So every information pertaining to tax planning, pertaining to the structure, is available online.
But it is complicated.
It is not at all complicated. You just spend a few minutes, go to the website of incometax.gov.in. That is government website. It will give you entire structure, which allowances are exempted, which allowances you can deduct, where you can contribute.
Got it.
Just to give you a feel of the tax planning, say suppose the total salary of a person is 30. I'm not even talking of CTC. I'm talking of the cash equivalent.
The fixed.
The cash what he is getting.
Okay.
13.5 lakhs, say suppose.
Okay.
Your tax planning can be so efficient that you will be ending paying nil tax.
How is that possible?
That is possible by tax planning. So you can invest or save towards various incentives and the structure your allowances. That we'll talk in the next video if it time permits.
Guys, let us know in the comments if you would like to cover this in our next video. Let's get back to our this question.
Sure.
I understand that we can save taxes. Let's say that we don't do anything to save our taxes, okay? Now, how do I calculate my in hand using these components?
All which you are getting cash component is your in hand.
What all this?
See, basic is cash, HRA is cash, all allowances except for meal allowance, conveyance allowance, etc.
Exactly, this meal, LTA, all of this can't be cash.
LTA is cash.
Achha,
LTA is cash. Meal is not cash.
Conveyance is cash.
Of course, you are spending. But you are getting cash from the company. So, it is in your hand. That is the cash in hand.
Got it. So, all of this is actually part of in hand.
Definitely part of in hand.
So, can I just calculate
You can always ask your company when you are negotiating, what you will be getting in hand, what are deemed benefits which are part of the CTC, like your contribution towards PF, contribution towards gratuity, contribution towards pension scheme, or expenditure towards meal allowance, expenditure towards conveyance. Those are not cash in hand. So definitely you can talk to your company, or the employee can talk to the company, what is the cash component and what is the deemed cash component.
Usually people don't do that. Like, we never ask that what is the cash components, what is the deemed
component. As a good employee, you can, employee who's aware, he or she should definitely ask.
Got it. Okay, let's get back to the in hand. So, if I understand, if I don't save my taxes, okay, if I don't do any of that, and I know that, okay, in a year, in my offer letter, it is written that this is my PSEC, this is my HRA, this is my allowances, this is my retirement contribution also we don't get right now.
Yeah.
Right? So these three components, whatever is cash.
You can simply calculate it.
Divide by 12, that's it?
Definitely.
Okay. Got it.
And another important question, since we are discussing Kirti, I don't know whether you are aware of it or not. There's a wage bill code, code of wage bills 2019, which became an act in 2020 and was to be implemented from 1st of April 2021, got deferred to October, but still notification is not there, and it may be implemented at any time.
Okay.
So it will have a major impact on this total salary structure. What there are two basic motives of the government which I can understand. Government has its own ways of doing it. But first let us look at the lower strata of the society. So suppose a poor person is getting only 10,000 rupees per month. What the people were doing, or the employers were doing, the basic pay was only 3,000, 7,000 was in terms of the allowances. And as we said, not all cash allowances, some deemed allowances also. So in what was happening is that he was getting very less amount in hand.
So say in hand would be 5-6 sort of thing.
Now government has said that at least 50% of the total salary has to be basic pay. So all other are allowances which are not cash.
Okay.
So 70% is not cash. It is all contribution towards various schemes. So he was only getting 3,000. It is only an assumption. Just to make the things clear. Now he will be getting 5,000. So his salary is getting, his cash component is getting increased by 2,000 rupees.
Our salary will also end up increasing, no?
On the other hand, it is reverse. What will happen is, people like you, the cash component will get reduced.
How?
Yes. Let me explain. Let us take only one simple aspect of provident fund.
Okay.
Now, for the sake of calculation, I think people should not get confused. So, let us take a simple example of 1 lakh rupees.
Okay.
30,000 is basic. 70,000 is the other allowances, HRA and retirement benefits and the flexible allowances.
Now, some part of the 70,000 is part of my in-hand, some part is not part of it.
We are not talking about in-hand now. We are talking about... How in hand will get affected, I'm telling you.
Okay.
Say earlier, the company was contributing, say your basic was 30,000. 12% of 30,000, that is 3,600 only, towards PF, which is part of the cash, which is not cash component,
okay.
of 70,000.
Right.
Now, the component is 50-50. The company will be contributing towards your PF instead of 3,600, 12% of 50,000, which makes 6,000. That is it simple? I hope it is not complicated. Calculation is not complicated. So it is only 2,400 rupees more towards your retirement benefits, towards your PF.
Okay. So now my contribution to PF is increasing.
Increasing, but your cash component is getting reduced.
But in the end, I'll end up getting this.
Yes,
but
at the time of retirement.
Okay. So this is just one component, like PF.
Like PF.
But my, like, for example, my basic pay is increasing enough, right? 30 to 50. So I end up getting 20,000 more in hand.
Kirti, you were, as I said, that say out of 30, 70 was the, even out of 70, the cash component is around maybe 55, maybe 60. 10,000 is not cash. That was also part of your hand. Now that will also get reduced by 2,400 only. It's a very small amount, but we should understand the implications.
Right.
And why government has done it? I was talking about two aspects. One, I already spoke about it. Second aspect is most of these allowances out of 70,000 which you are getting are exempted or deductible from the total income to work out the taxable salary.
Okay.
We'll work. We'll talk in detail on the tax planning structure. But when it increases to 50,000, now only 50,000, say, you are able to avail 100% of towards deductions and exemptions. So only 50,000 will be exempted. So that is the difference. So you will end up paying some more
taxes.
But
we are already paying so much taxes.
See, you should be proud of paying taxes. You are contributing to the economy of the country.
Topic for another discussion.
Okay.
So now we understood that how the wage change, the structure change will impact us. Mostly our enhanced salary will end up getting reduced, right?
It may get up ending, cash component may get up reduced, but I think most of the good corporate companies will come out with some methods to compensate you or increase your CTC component so that people are not at loss. I am sure for that. Because employee-friendly companies will certainly do it.
Okay. Let's see which companies do it, which companies don't. This is also a good topic of discussion in the comments, right? So you can tell us below that which companies do you think will take care of the employees and which companies do you think will just let it be and get the inactivity.
This is another interesting topic that... Yeah. The companies, only those companies which take care of the employees can survive.
Now, let's start with discussing all the components of salary in detail. Okay, like basic salary, HRA, gratuity and everything in detail. Okay, so let's start with the basic one, the HRA.
Let us start with basic itself.
Okay, basic salary.
Basic is basic. Nothing to be discussed on it. It is a cash component, straight away.
Okay.
All the benefits are calculated.
Okay.
Your retirement benefits, your provident fund, your contribution towards pension, your contribution towards the pension scheme, gratuity, all are get calculated.
It's all percentage of basic.
Basic.
So, like a smart thing would be to increase the basic or reduce. Okay, that is for another video discussion, now. Okay, got it. So,
But now you don't have a choice. At least 50%, any employer will have no choice. At least 50% will have to be basic.
Once the new structure comes. Okay, now let's get to the HRA part. What is HRA?
HRA is basically your compensation. Since company is not able to provide accommodation to you. Not all companies are providing accommodation. If they are providing, they are providing to senior people. So in lieu of that, they give you HRA. So in the tax planning structure, we'll consider how much is tax, how much HRA is exempted and how much is taxable.
Okay.
So and third is...
No, wait.
Yeah.
I have questions regarding HRA.
Sure.
So, we get this money. So, when we fill taxes, right, usually we are asked how much is our rent and depending on that, our HRA is calculated, something like that, right?
No. HRA is fixed by the government norms and by the company norms.
Okay, so for taxes, for 16
taxes,
and all?
That's a separate subject. There are three conditions. Okay. We'll discuss in the tax planning structure.
Okay, so that is for taxes.
Taxes.
This HRA is fixed by the company.
Yeah, yeah.
Get that much HRA.
It may differ from level to level of the employee.
Okay. Since we are talking about HRA, my next question is, some people end up buying houses to save rent and all that. So are they still given HRA? Okay, this is also a taxes question, but still.
No, this is a separate question in itself. Whether you should own your house or you should stay in rented houses. It is a common saying that wise people stay in rented houses, but I don't agree with this. At least one house you should have.
That is emotional you talking or?
No, even from tax planning point of view.
Okay.
At least one house where you would like to settle down after retirement, you should definitely have.
Okay.
We can discuss it separately also. But till you are able to achieve that financial goal where you are able to buy. And suppose you are today in Bangalore, you purchase a flat there and you have to switch your job to Chennai or to Hyderabad or to Pune. Then you'll have to have a rented accommodation. Or say suppose your accommodation is 50 kilometers away in Bangalore. Now you want to stay near the company just to save on the commutation. You can very well do it and you can get the HRA from the company.
Right.
Another interesting thing is that even if you are staying with your family, you can pay rent to them and claim for HRA.
Right. So, to our family, I can pay
rent
definitely.
To my family. But that becomes the income of the family. They'll have to take care in their income.
Okay, got it. Another discussion, right?
Yeah.
So, what my understanding is, HRA is also a simple cash component that you get. You can't change it. It is told in the offer letter itself. You can't do anything, right?
You can't. Can't tinker it.
Yeah, right.
What best you can do is, what sort of accommodation you want. You want 2 BHK, 3 BHK. Rest would be your saving. But when it comes to tax planning, actual HRA received, there are three components we'll discuss in detail in the next part.
Right. But it is included in our in-hand, right?
Yes,
HRA
yes,
as well
yes,
as basic.
Yes.
Okay. Let's move ahead to the retirement ones, gratuity, PF.
Normally, 12% of your basic goes towards the PF contribution.
What is PF? It very clear.
Yeah, PF is Provident Fund.
What does it mean?
Provident Fund is basically planning for your... it's basically a retirement benefit. And it's a very good thing that it is a forced saving. 12% company contributes. Basic, the legislation says 8.33% minimum. And maximum of 15, the cap is 15,000. Suppose your basic pay is 30,000. Even on 50,000 only, the company would say that I would pay PF. But normally, good companies don't do it. They do it on the actual basic.
Right.
So, suppose your basic is 30,000, 3,600 company will be contributing, 3,600 you will be contributing.
Right.
And this corpus will get built up towards and will help you towards your financial goals, which we spoke in the last video also.
Right. I have a few questions. Number one, when we talk about retirement, right, we get PF and everything, we can claim after retirement, right? So this retirement can be at any point, anytime I stop working and I can take retirement right now?
Kirti, this I will have to check up. I think it is minimum 5 years. For gratuity, it is minimum 5 years. So I have to check up for the Provident Fund also. But one thing is for sure, that Provident Fund is transferable.
Okay.
So suppose you leave one organization, go to another organization, that I would say that until unless you have decided to be in the corporate sector, don't give up your Provident Fund. It will help you in your financial goals.
Got it. So also, is there any fixed age requirement that okay
but
after
yes,
this
if
age?
You give resignation, then definitely it will be reimbursed.
Acha.
Yes.
Okay. So, and if I'm not earning right now, right?
If you are on your own, the entire amount will be refunded. You'll have to give up some undertaking or something. So, entire amount is refunded by the fund.
I didn't get it.
So suppose you resign and you're not taking about any job.
Then I can take it, right? Not if I'm working somewhere else, then I can't. Okay. Another question, is there any like forced age limit that now you have to retire and take your PF, or like even if you're working after this age, you can take your PF or anything like that?
I know about the government rules. It is 60.
Very tough questions.
Yeah,
I know.
It is 60. No, but I see, as long as you are working, see, the private sector allows working about to 65 years, 70 years also.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go on contributing towards Provident Fund. Nobody stops it.
Okay. Got it. The entire PF just keeps accumulated. Okay.
And one thing is important. Mm-hmm. At certain point of stage of life or certain conditions, you can also take permanent withdrawals from PF.
What is that?
Marriage of self-marriage. It could be self-marriage, it could be marriage of a child, it could be construction of a house. There are certain terms and conditions where you can for portion. There are period of linked to the total withdrawals which you can make.
Acha, so we can make a few withdrawals.
Yes.
Got it. Again, we don't
but
have
I would
to go
discourage.
To the
acha, this is the amount we should continue to build.
Okay. Personal opinion. Now let's get to the gratuity. What is gratuity?
Gratuity is basically, again, as the word suggests, it's a deferred payment. Gratuitous. See, for every completed year of service, 15 days of the salary is paid at the time of retirement, subject to maximum, which is tax-free, is 20 lakhs.
Acha. Okay, this is tax-free.
Up to 20 lakhs.
Okay, got it. The entire accumulated thing, right? Okay. The rest is taxable. Okay, got it. What other thing is there in post-retirement things, PF gratuity, and anything else that I'm missing?
Another is pension, but normally people don't opt for pension.
Okay.
But when we come to tax planning, I will discuss about the NPS.
Mm-hmm.
50,000 at least we can contribute and help in tax planning. That we'll discuss.
Okay. Coming to the flexible allowances, these usually differ company from company, right? Some of them, as we discussed, are cashable. Some of them don't have cash value. Like, they just are things that happen, like meals and conveyance and all of that, right? Okay. Right. Anything else that we should cover around this?
I think we have covered everything on this.
Right.
But if you have any questions, definitely we can take up. Say, suppose in allowances also, beginning also we discussed, the companies definitely discuss with you what allowances you would like to take among the total component. Say, suppose you are living very close to the company, you may give up the conveyance allowance.
Usually this is not given as an option. Like, for us, it was not an option that we can choose for this.
No, if you talk to the company, there are certain, there's a host of allowances where you can pick up and choose, and subject to certain limits.
Okay. Got it. Okay. I guess we have discussed all the salary things. Before ending, I just wanted to discuss a bit about stocks. So there is a lot of confusion around stocks also, that we get the stocks, but some companies have different things. Like, we get at minimum price and then we can sell at maximum price or something like that. Would you like to talk a bit about RSUs?
See, stock options, when it comes to normally, the companies will try to give benefit to the employees as a reward. So, depending upon their board approvals and all, at what price, and of course the regulatory approvals also, you cannot simply give away. They have to take care of the market price also. So, whatever the market rates are, with a certain discount they can offer. Like in IPOs also, you would have heard that there's an employee reserved quota at a small discount of the price which is given to the public. So similar cases can be in this also, where employees are given a share at a discount and they are able to either sell it in the open market or maybe surrender it at the time of leaving the company.
Got it. I guess that covers most of what we wanted to discuss. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments. We'll definitely take them up in the next upcoming videos. And we'll talk about taxes in our next video.
Kirti, again, I'll just like to remind everyone, like all this information which I am talking about or which we have discussed is available online. So in this digital age, if you want, you can just go to the site, do effective tax planning for yourself. But if you talk to your HR person or your tax consultant, he will be or she will be able to guide you to maximize the investments, savings, so that you are able to minimize the tax.
Technically, if people are watching the video, they are already finding the information online.
Definitely. But what is happening is, normally we would love to see videos and all, but in print also it is available. You can just download the PDF versions.
From the official sites.
Always better to go to the official websites.
Right.
And the best website is incometax.gov.in.
Is it good?
Definitely. Every information is available.
Great. All right. I'll also try using it for the first time. I've never used it.
I don't know whether you are aware of the AIS.
What is that?
It's a recent introduction, annual income summary, where entire is available on the, instead of AS 26, mm-hmm. 26 AS, this is the new version where everything is available, whatever cash you are getting. Whatever accounts you have linked, in terms of dividends, in terms of your stock income, whatever you are getting gets reflected. So tax return becomes very easy. Filing tax returns becomes very, very easy.
Yep. We'll discuss all of this in our next videos. Stay tuned and thank you so much for watching the video. We hope you really liked it. Please don't forget to like, share and subscribe. It will mean a lot to us.
Thank you very much, Kirti. Thank you. It's a pleasure discussing on all these. Thank you.